でありさまになっちまったな。
ああ。
板倉とそのお月の連中だけが死んだらしいじゃねえか。ん？その顔だとお前さんの目的は果たせなかったみてえだな。
なあ。
ん？
この騒動で店、鶴屋はどうなっちまうんだ。店が火事になっただけならまだしも、客として来ていた京都女子大が店で死んだんだ。役人たちも黙っちゃいないだろう。
それなら心配ねえ。どうも幕府の連中は今回の一件闇に消すらしい。
え？
どうやら板倉が祇園に来たっていうことは幕府内でも極秘なことだったようだ。おそらくそのことを知った女将がうまいことを幕府の人間と手打ちでもしたんだろう。店の修復も裏で幕府が面倒を見るってことになったらしい。
女将が？
まあ祇園一のやり手女将って呼ばれるだけのことはあるな。
そうだな。それはそうと、伊藤さんの方はどうだ？
ああ、問題はそっちの方だ。今、俺の馴染みの医者に見せてはいるが、まだ意識は戻ってない。
怪我の具合は？
肩から胸にかけてバッサリ。医者に言わせると、自力で火事場から抜け出たことが不思議なくらいらしい。
そうか。
まあ、幸い注射は外れてるみてえだ。さすが天下の伊藤一等祭って言ったところか。まあ奴のことだ。そのうち目を覚ますだろうよ。
ああ。
それよりな、キリュウ、伊藤が気を失う前おかしなことを言ってたんだが。
おかしなこと？
ああ、奴は新影ってな。
奴？小次郎のことか。新影ってなんだ？
おい、声がでかい。俺にも意味がわからん。それより女将がこっちに来るぞ。
Hello, this is Egomaniac, and welcome back to Let's Play Kenzan. Last time, we had a huge battle in Tsuruya, which burned to the ground in the aftermath. Apparently, things didn't go really according to plan for Kiryuu and Ito. Ito was obviously defeated by Kojiro. The latter's whereabouts are unknown, and Ito is clinging to life somewhere in Koetsu's estate. Kiryuu tried to track down Marume. Marume, before he arrived, killed Administrator Itakura, who was in turn trying to kidnap Haruka. Apparently she is the one he was ordered to find, but it's not clear why. Then, when Kiryuu faced Marume, the latter escaped before Kiryuu could get any answers about what happened at Sekigahara from him. But for now, Kiryuu is well, Haruka is safe, and Ito is still alive. It also appears that, eventually, everything will be right as rain with the Tsuruya. It's interesting to note that they don't freeze the townspeople for these cutscenes if they don't have voice acting. So you'll get a lot of randomly generated NPCs trying to walk right through you while you're trying to have an important conversation. I do like how they also allowed the player character, to react. Or in this case, the madam. So she wants us to go and check on Haruka because she's been depressed, and Haruka's staying at some other establishment called the Kame no Ya, which is right here, literally 50 meters away.
遥かが会いたくないってどういうことだ。なあ、鈴がどうこうって言うてたけど、ようわからんわ。鈴？あの子、塞ぎ込んだまんま誰とも口聞こうとせえへんねん。まあ、あんな事件の後や。無理もないんやろうけど。どないすんの？このまま放っとく？いや。
どうしても会って話がしたい。お前、なんとか遥を連れ出してきてもらえないか。まあ、できんこともないけど、ちょっと時間かかるやもしれんわ。
わかった。ちょうど俺も今から出かける用事がある。それが終わったら、また顔を出す。まあ、やるだけやってみるわ。お春がこのままやったら、 亀の屋さんにも迷惑かけてまうやろし。すまない。ほな。
Well, it's kind of an empty scene, but I guess it serves a purpose if you saved after Chapter 7 and then took a break before you continued the game. Or else it just shows that Kiryuu is a lot more dense than the player about why Haruka might be upset. Anyway, this chapter, or this update, is going to go a lot like the second part of Chapter 7, in that there's a lot of running between point A and point B, and then back to point A again. So for now, we're once more going to visit Koetsu. He said he had something he wanted to talk about. Now, the madam seemed to actually be familiar with Honami Koetsu, as in he was a regular customer, and that's not too surprising. Actually, the real-life Koetsu was, of course, a wealthy and very educated man, and as men of his time in that situation were wont to do, he was said to have spent a lot of time in Shimabara, in the Pleasure District. That is also how he's usually depicted in fiction, as an aesthete, of course, who wants only the finest things in life. So he actually brings Miyamoto Musashi to Shimabara for a good time in the novel and in a lot of the film portrayals of Musashi's life. That scene, though, is instead kind of mirrored in Kenzan with the Chapter 4 scene with Musashi and the old monk. Now, there are three bounties available in this chapter. We're going to pick up the notices for all three now, but there will only be two that we can get, actually, currently in Chapter 8, because the first one that we just saw requires nighttime, and there won't be any free-form, open nighttime segments in Chapter 8 at all. The other two we can get in the daytime. One will actually be in this video, and one will be in the screenshot portion, along with the side quests. So I'm getting a little bit tired of all the random battles. I've been trying to spare the videos from them, but it happens a lot when I'm running around doing side quests too. So following this update, we'll actually be getting a new set of swords. It's time for some real weapon crafting. And again, that will also be shown off, the process for that and the intermediates and everything, in the thread, in the screenshot portion.
実は、お前じゃない宮本武蔵について、また妙な情報を聞きつけてな。どんな情報だ。このところ、宮本武蔵が宝蔵院に来るって噂が広まってるらしい。宝蔵院?宝蔵院といえば、あの奈良にある。そう、あの槍の宝蔵院だ。先代の当主、陰影から伝わる宝蔵院流僧術で有名な
あの名門寺院だ。でもどうして武蔵が宝蔵院に。また道場破りをするって話なのか。いや、そうじゃねえ。武蔵が宝蔵院の武術会に参加するって噂なのよ。武術会？ああ、どうも宝蔵院じゃ年に1回全国から剣士を集めて武術会を開いているらしい。ちょうど 7日後、
その武術会が開催される。じゃあその武術会に武蔵が姿を現すと。そういう噂なんだ。だが吉岡道場にもまだ姿を現していない武蔵が本当に来るんだろうか。ああ、それは俺も気になってる。だからこれはあくまで噂でしかねえと思ってるんだが。そうか。
どうするんだお前は。宝蔵院に行ってみるのか。それしかないだろう。ただ吉岡で待っていても埒が明かないからな。そうか。でも気をつけろよ。鶴屋の一件といい、どうもお前さんの周りはきな臭くなってきてるぞ。分かってる。それじゃあ俺はしばらく祇園を出る。伊藤さんのことは頼んだ。ああ、
So now it's back to point A again. Gotta go talk to Haruka. We're not gonna actually head straight there. There's one little side thing to take care of first, but we'll get there pretty soon. Now, I mentioned before that little cutscene that we were going to be doing some weapon upgrading, mainly for the tachi. And I also mentioned in the assassin fight in the last update about the type of sword that the assassins were using. The leader was using one called a nodachi, and that is the same type that Kojiro uses. It's a very long katana, basically. And actually, in real life, in all accounts of Sasaki Kojiro's life, and in all fictional media depictions of him that I know of, he's using the same type of weapon. His sword was actually an old family heirloom from centuries before this time, referred to as the drying pole. And it was especially unique because in this era, in the late Sengoku and the early Edo period, a lot of those long nodachi and those unique swords were being cut down into regular katana or tachi-sized swords. But his family didn't allow that to happen, and he was one of the few people who was considered a real master with it alive at the time. So it was kind of his signature, made him stand out, and that suits him, apparently. Again, as mentioned in most depictions of him, he also wore flashy clothes, and he liked to stand out. Musashi himself actually used no particular famous swords. He's never associated with any. In fact, most of his duels, he used bokuto, wooden swords, as was mostly the custom, since most duels were not intended to be to the death.
Hmm? 天型を得たり。
So we didn't need Shichigoro for this one. We got the picture from that old guy just sitting over there on the bench. And he only appears in the daytime from chapter 8 forward. What we learned is the second of only three heat actions for the Kodachi. So it's, along with the Greatsword, it does get only three. And this one will never become obsolete like the last one, because this is the only move I can remember, at least, in the game where it works when an enemy is guarding. So the enemy is facing you, he's got his guard up, and you've got the Kodachi out, you can use this to attack him. Other than just regular attacks, you know, like the Shibasawa's rock cutter move, for example, there aren't any other ways to break guard, there aren't any other heat actions that do that. And as long as we're talking about the Kodachi, sometimes people wonder, maybe if nobody used the dual sword style except for Musashi and maybe a few others, why did samurai even wear a second sword, a wakizashi or a kodachi? Actually, not everybody's completely sure. They might have been used for executions, they might have been used especially for close quarters fighting, and they were definitely used for seppuku, to commit ritual suicide. But they were also easier to get permission to carry, since without exception, only samurai were allowed to carry the main sword, the katana or the tachi. Well, sometimes maybe community leaders or what you call like neighborhood watchmen might have been allowed to carry wakizashi, since it wasn't exactly the so-called soul of the samurai. And eventually, of course, organized criminals like proto-yakuza might have used similar blades. In many cases, those neighborhood watchmen or the community leaders might have morphed into criminals or organized crime families themselves. Modern Yakuza 2, they still have kind of an image of wielding those short knives or short swords, I should say, or long knives, similar in style to the wakizashi or kodachi. However, of course, they're not carried openly, and they're not just worn by the average person or anything like that. It's more of just something that I think more movies associate with the Yakuza. In fact, actually, in Japan, you need, in current times, you need a permit even to have a pocket knife. So, let alone a gun. I mean, anything over, I think it's like 2 or 2.5 inches or something requires a special permission. And it's not the kind of thing the average person can get either. I mean, you have to have an actual reason to need it. So this fight is not particularly tough, but it is kind of unusual being in Gion that Monosuke here has an actual sword. And one kind of crappy thing about it is we are not allowed to use the sword-stealing heat action we got from Komaki. I guess because it's Gion and we just cannot use swords in Gion, even if you rip it out of his hands. So I'm going to give up on that idea. The best thing I find as far as just convenience against any groups of enemy when you can't use your blades is to use the umbrella. It's got a pretty low power, pretty low power in the sense that it doesn't guard break very well and it gets its guard broken pretty easily, but it does a lot of damage and flips them all up to the air, knocks them down pretty much every time it connects. Sadly, Kiryuu doesn't do the little dance unless he's wearing his kabuki makeup. So Monosuke has a lot of health, but he's not too good at the guard breaking or the grip breaking, so it pretty much just means he takes longer to cheat. Not every fight will go like this, it's just that since I haven't missed any side quests or any training yet, They want to make it, I think, still possible for people who did, or for people who were skipping things and blowing past them. So it might be a little easy right now. Incidentally, like I said, Kiryuu doesn't do the little dance with the umbrella heat action when he's not in the Kabuki Theater, but it does count as a separate heat action. So if you're going for completion, you want to do it at least once in the theater and at least once outside the theater. And you can equip the umbrella as your other weapon instead of a greatsword or a kodachi anytime outside of Gion if you want. Alright, now that we've worked out our aggression, we can see what's troubling Haruka.
So, tsuretekita de. Ato wa antara de hanashi ya.
Haruka.
よしの世話をかけたな。あとは遥かと2人で話す。分かったわ。ほな。鶴屋の女将から聞いた。塞ぎ込んでるらしいな。何があった？別に。別にってことはないだろう。あんな騒ぎの後だ。落ち込むのは当たり前だ。だけど。 どうして俺のことを避けるんだ？どうした？ これは？
これと同じ鈴、おじさんの刀についてた。どこでこれを？ 私の家族を殺した男の刀についてたの。あの時のことを忘れないためにずっと持ってた。お前、おじさんが板倉様を。違う。板倉は丸目さんが。何よ。何か隠してるならちゃんと話してよ。
とにかく違うんだ。板倉を切ったのは俺じゃない。じゃあなんでおじさんはあの時鶴屋に。やっぱりそうなんだ。何？やっぱりおじさんが私の家族を殺した。
おじさんが宮本武蔵なんでしょう。だからおじさん、いつまでたっても宮本武蔵のこと見つけられないんだ。自分のことだから。あるか。俺はもういいわよ。おじさんなんて信じないから。おじさんなんか信じたら私がバカだった。
鈴のことはいつかちゃんと事情を話す。今はそれしか言えない。俺は今から奈良へ行く。宮本武蔵が宝蔵院という寺にやってくるという噂を聞いた。だから直接会って確かめてくる。
そんな嘘ついてバレたから逃げるんでしょ。
今は 信じてくれとしか言えない。でも俺は仕事の約束は必ず守る。それだけは分かってくれ。じゃあ。
Well, we've lost Haruka's trust. But there's nothing really you can do about that right now, so just head back to the Tatsuya. But how are we going to get to the Holzolin? We really don't know anything about it, let alone where it is. Well, I'm sure something will come along to guide us. Perfect. So now we've got a new location on our map. What he said is true. You just go straight across from the litter, if you take that, to the Riverside Tea House. And that's what we'll be doing next time on Let's Play Kenzan.